Good morning, everybody. Welcome to your 20th online lecture on in general surgery for BDS students. Today we will be discussing hernias. And basically, at the end of this lecture, by the end of this lecture, I would expect you to know what a hernia is. You should know the common types of hernias. Then, as inguinal hernia is very common and important from examination point of view, I would expect you to know the anatomy of the inguinal canal, the contents of the spermatic cord, the different layers of the hernial sac, and the causes of etiology of hernias, basics of the treatment of hernias, and then I would expect you to know something about the different varieties of hernias that are commonly seen in addition to the inguinal hernia. For example, paraumbilical hernia and femoral hernia, incisional hernias. So we will keep it simple so that it is easy to comprehend, and we will go in a stepwise fashion. So by definition, hernia is a protrusion, or it means to bud or to protrude, or an offshoot or a rupture. From a medical point of view, as a medical student, you can define hernia as an abnormal protrusion of a viscus or a part of a viscus through an opening in the muscles of the abdominal wall, whether it is artificial or natural, with a sac covering it. So basically what we are saying is that any point in the abdominal wall, the cavity of the abdomen, at any point in the muscular abdominal wall, if there is a weakness, through that the abdominal contents can protrude, and they will of course be covered by the peritoneal, parietal peritoneum, that will be pushed out, and then the viscus will follow it. So just remember these two, three important points: that it is an abnormal protrusion through the muscles of the abdominal wall, where a sac of peritoneum, which may contain a viscus or part of a abdominal viscus, that protrudes outside under the skin. So the common hernias are inguinal hernia, midline abdominal surgery scar through which incisional hernias can take place, a femoral hernia, epigastric hernia in the linea alba midline through the degussating fibers of the linea alba, umbilical and paraumbilical hernias. Umbilical hernia you usually see in infants, and in adults you see paraumbilical hernias. Then there are relatively rare forms of hernias. There's the obturator hernia, and then there's the spigelian hernia, lumbar hernia, and the gluteal hernia. About these rare hernias, you basically need to know the very basic information about them, but among the common hernias you need to understand the inguinal hernia in full detail, and paraumbilical and umbilical hernias, epigastric hernias, and then you need to understand the basics, or the at least the basic anatomy of incisional and femoral hernias. So inguinal hernia is the commonest hernia, and it comprises about 73% of the all the hernias. And that is because the anatomy of the inguinal region is such that there is an inherent defect there, because the spermatic cord is going to come out and go to the scrotum, or to the in case of females, the round ligament has to come out and go to the labia majora. So there is an anatomical defect there, and because of the deep ring and the cord structures, and that is why this is the commonest site for herniation. Then femoral hernia has an incidence of 17%, more common in women. Umbilical hernia 8.5%. In umbilical hernia, I would also include the para-umbilical hernia. In clinical practice in our country, I would rate the incidence of para-umbilical hernias and epigastric hernias as more than femoral hernia. And the other, all other causes then constitute about 1.5%. So what are the basic causes of hernia formation? An important cause, of course, is an inherent anatomical defect, as in inguinal hernia, the deep inguinal ring. And then another important cause would be weakness of the abdominal musculature. That can also then make it easier for the hernia to form. So basically, the causes of hernia formation, number one is straining, as in chronic constipation or urinary stricture or enlarged prostate, or because of chronic cough. So that chronic straining ultimately leads to creation of a gap in the muscle fibers of the abdominal wall, ultimately leading to pushing out of the peritoneal sac and abdominal viscous through that defect. Same applies to lifting of heavy weights. Carrying heavy weights without wearing a protective belt, it has the same effect as straining, chronic cough, as in tuberculosis, chronic bronchitis, bronchial asthma, and emphysema. Similarly, chronic constipation, whether it is habitual or there is a rectal stricture. Urinary causes like benign prostatic hyperplasia or prostatic enlargement, carcinoma of the prostate in old age. And in young patients, stricture of the urethra, and in very young patients, the infants, phimosis or stenosis of the external urethral meatus. So all of these causes ultimately come under straining. The primary pathology is the straining, and the causes of those that straining are different. Then obesity, on the one hand, has a weak muscular wall, and on the other hand, there is increased intraperitoneal fat, visceral fat, and therefore increased intra-abdominal pressure, and that tends to push the contents out through any weakness in the muscles. Same applies to pregnancy. The muscles are stretched, and there is a space occupying uterus inside the abdominal content, raising the pressure inside and pushing, tends to push the viscera out. And it is common to see development of para-umbilical hernias in pregnancy. Smoking, of course, there are chronic bronchitis and exacerbation of asthma and cough. That, of course, causes herniation. Ascites is free fluid in the peritoneal cavity, and of course that also creates weight and pressure inside the abdominal cavity and tends to push the peritoneal sac out through any weakness in the abdominal wall. Appendectomy, where muscle cutting has been done instead of going through the splitting the fibers of the muscle, where the incision has had to be extended by muscle cutting, can lead to incisional hernias. Then there are congenital hernias, of which the commonest is a patent processus vaginalis among the inguinal hernia categories, and umbilical hernia, the central umbilical hernia in children. Then there are familial collagen disorders, which can also cause congenital weakness of the abdominal muscle and lead to hernia formation. So basically, the parts of the hernia are: one is the sac. That sac is formed by the peritoneum, the parietal peritoneum of the abdominal wall, which the parietal peritoneum, as you know, lines the internal surface of the abdominal cavity inside the muscles. So that will form the sac. Then there are the coverings. Coverings are usually derived from all the muscular musculoepineurotic layers that through which the sac and the hernia passes. And then you have the contents. Contents of the sac are the fat or greater omentum or the any viscous, whether a part of it or a complete viscous. So that would form the content, as well as the neurovascular structures that accompany this. So as I mentioned earlier, sac is a diverticulum of the peritoneum, and it has a mouth, neck, body, and fundus. Neck is narrow in indirect hernia, but wider in direct hernias. We will discuss why. And the body of the sac is usually thin in infants and in children, and in newly formed indirect hernias. However, it is thick in direct and long-standing hernias because it adapts to carrying the weight of the hernial organs. So the in long-standing hernias, the sac and the coverings tend to become thick. If the content of the sac is greater omentum, then it is called an omentocele, and it can usually be reduced easily, but later on it develops adhesions inside the peritoneal sac of the hernia, and then it becomes difficult to reduce. When the contents are loops of intestine, then it is called an enterocele. Usually small bowel, but in some cases the large bowel may also present. Rictus hernia, where a portion of the circumference of the bowel is the content, not the whole loop, but only one wall of the loop of gut is protruding through the hernia, and this can be generally seen in femoral hernias and small hernias. Cystocele is where urinary bladder is the content or part of the posterior wall of the sac. The urinary bladder, as you know, is extraperitoneal. Similarly, parts of the large gut are retroperitoneal. So these can form the posterior wall of the sac, and these part of these can slide out, and these would also be called sliding hernias. Ovary, often with the fallopian tube, may be the content of a hernia, and rarely when there is a Meckel's diverticulum is discovered in the hernial sac, that is also called a Litter's hernia. This is a Richter's hernia and this is Litter's hernia. So let's come to a very important VIVA question. You will also encounter such questions about the anatomy of the hernia in your MCQs. So anatomy of the inguinal canal. It is an oblique passage in the lower part of the abdominal wall, about 4 centimeters long, extending from the deep inguinal ring here to the superficial inguinal ring here. So this part is the inguinal canal. Boundaries. External oblique aponeurosis. As you know, the external oblique inserts into the inguinal ligament. And the iliac crest. So the external oblique aponeurosis and the conjoint muscle laterally. Now about the conjoint muscle, you need to understand this in front and behind part. Here you see the conjoint tendon arising from the internal oblique and transversus abdominis on the inside of the external oblique aponeurosis. And here at the deep ring, it is in front of the deep ring. Then the fibers arch over it, forming the superior relations of the cord, and then they insert into the pubic crest. And here now the spermatic cord has become superficial and the conjoint tendon inserts behind it. So laterally the conjoint tendon arises anterior to the deep ring, then arches above, becomes a superior relation, and then inserts behind the spermatic cord. So that is why it is mentioned here, the conjoint muscle laterally. Then behind the inguinal canal, you have the inferior epigastric artery and vein, fascia transversalis, which is the extra peritoneal condensation of fascia outside the peritoneal wall. This white area that you see here, that would be covered with fascia transversalis. And in the medial part, you have the insertion of the conjoint tendon. So these are posterior relations of the inguinal canal. Above or superiorly, you have the arched fibers of the internal oblique, forming the conjoint muscle and tendon, and below you have the inguinal ligament. The interned J-shaped leaf of the inguinal ligament forms the floor of the inguinal canal. So the contents of the inguinal canal would be spermatic cord in males, round ligament in females, and the ilioinguinal nerve in both sexes. So now we come to the superficial and the deep inguinal ring, and we need to understand the anatomy of the superficial inguinal ring. It is triangular in shape, and please remember that it is not a triangle like this. It is a triangle which arches to one side and comes like this. Therefore, it has a supromedial and a infralateral crus or the margin. Is approximately 1.25 centimeter and allows the tip of a finger to go in. During surgery, you can check while closing this. And the deep inguinal ring is a U-shaped condensation of the transversalis fascia, which lies about 1.25 centimeters above the inguinal ligament, midway between the symphysis pubis and the anterior superior iliac spine. As I will explain in the next, I will explain both these points in the next picture. This triangular superficial inguinal ring in real life is tilted laterally. This is the symphysis pubis, pubic tubercle, pubic crest, anterior superior iliac spine. because this tilts laterally, goes like this in real life, so the medial edge is supromedial and the lower edge is infralateral. And the other point that I just mentioned is that the deep inguinal ring is located at the middle of a line drawn from the anterior superior crest to the symphysis pubis. Please remember that the inguinal ligament extends from the anterior superior spine to the pubic tubercle. This green line here represents the inguinal ligament. So the mid inguinal point would be here, a little further lateral, and the middle of the line drawn between the anterior superior spine and the symphysis pubis, because this is longer, so that the middle would be a little bit lateral. So the deep ring lies at the center point of a line extended from the anterior superior spine to the symphysis pubis, not middle of the inguinal ligament. This point in the middle of a line extending from the anterior superior spine to the symphysis pubis is called a mid inguinal point, and the middle of the inguinal ligament lies further lateral. So there's a difference between the middle of the inguinal ligament and the mid inguinal point. Students generally confuse these things. So again, here the external oblique aponeurosis and the muscles coming down and then arching inwards, forming the anterior wall of the inguinal canal and the floor of the inguinal canal. The inguinal ligament is this part of this yellow part, and then this blue or gray part. This is the inguinal ligament, which arches inward, and this is the inguinal canal. Here you see the conjoint tendon or the conjoint muscle and tendon arching over the inguinal canal, forming the roof. Then you have the posterior wall formed by the parietal peritoneum and the fascia transversalis, as well as a few fibers from the transversus abdominis. Now we come to this picture. You see the deep or the internal inguinal ring here, and this is the inguinal canal. Anteriorly, it is bounded by the external oblique muscle and its aponeurosis, which form in the lower part the inguinal ligament. This is the inguinal ligament, which is forming the anterior wall and the floor of the inguinal canal. Then you see the internal oblique muscle fibers and the conjoint tendon arching over the inguinal canal. In the lateral part, it would be anterior, and in the medial part, it will insert behind the inguinal canal. And then the posterior wall, you see the parietal peritoneum, fascia transversalis, and a few fibers of the transversus abdominis. The inferior epigastric vessels are located immediately medial to the deep inguinal ring, and they are extraperitoneal. Okay, so during surgery, when you have opened up the inguinal canal from the front, you can actually see these vessels, and they identify the location of the deep ring. And then you know that you have reached the neck of the hernial sac when you identify the inferior epigastric vessels. This is a view from inside the abdomen. So this would be the posterior aspect of the inguinal canal from inside the abdomen. And Here you see the external iliac vein which will come out below the inguinal ligament. This is the inguinal ligament, and you are looking at the right side of the body from inside. This is the femoral sheath in which the artery, vein and the lymph node of Crokae lie, and this would form the femoral sheath, and this part of the femoral sheath is the femoral canal where the femoral hernia comes out. Then you have this transversalis fascia and the deep ring here just lateral to the inferior epigastric vessels. The peritoneum has been removed from this surface to show you the transversalis fascia. So basically the Hasselbeck's triangle, we can identify that now. The lateral border of the rectus muscle forms the medial margin. This is the rectus abdominal muscle, and laterally you have the inferior epigastric artery and vein, and inferiorly you have the inguinal ligament. So this Hasselbeck triangle would be forming the posterior wall of the inguinal canal and extending above it also. So what are the contents of the spermatic cord? Another important question. In inguinal hernia there are a lot of viva questions. For example, the boundaries of the Hasselbeck triangle that we just discussed. Then you have the contents of the spermatic cord. So it would include vas deferens, artery to the vas deferens, testicular and cremasteric arteries, then genital branch of the genitofemoral nerve, pampiniform plexus of veins, sympathetic plexus around the artery to the vas deferens, then remains of the processus vaginalis, embryologically development of the tunica vaginalis of the testes. It develops from the processus vaginalis, and infants this can remain patent to form a patent processus vaginalis, one form of a complete or a scrotal type of congenital inguinal hernia. Then the coverings of the spermatic cord. Now you have to visualize that say for example a viscous is pushing the parietal peritoneum out through the deep ring, through the inguinal canal and going out under the skin. So the internal spermatic fascia would be formed by the fascia transversalis. The sac will be formed by the parietal peritoneum, and the internal spermatic fascia, which is the next lining going from inside out, would be formed by the internal spermatic fascia, would be called the internal spermatic fascia from the fascia transversalis. Then from the fibers of the internal and transversus abdominis muscles, the conjoint tendon, you get the cremasteric fascia and the cremasteric muscle. Then external spermatic fascia is formed by when the contents of the inguinal canal come out through the superficial inguinal ring. Then you have the external spermatic fascia coming from the margins of the superficial inguinal ring, which is in the external oblique aponeurosis. So in this picture we see the right part of the scrotum and the superficial inguinal ring. As you see, this triangular opening is tilted laterally. The pubic tubercle would probably be lying here behind the cord, and the pubic crest is here. So the infralateral margin and the supromedial margin of the superficial inguinal ring. From here, from the external oblique fibers, the contents of the spermatic cord will take the outermost layer, which is the external spermatic fascia. Then inside you have the cremasteric muscle and fascia, which was derived from the internal oblique transversus abdominis and the fibers of the conjoint tendon. And inside that you would then have the internal spermatic fascia. Then you have the pampiniform plexus of veins, the artery to the vas, as you see this on the vas deferens, this small vessel. And then you have this large artery, which is the testicular artery, the epididymis, head of the epididymis body and tail, and the vas deferens is connecting here. The testes is ensheathed by a visceral layer of tunica vaginalis, and then you have an outer layer of the tunica vaginalis forming the parietal tunica vaginalis. So the coverings of indirect hernia from inside out would be extraperitoneal tissue derived from the transversalis fascia, internal spermatic fascia, cremasteric fascia, external spermatic fascia, and then skin. So this picture tries to tell you the difference between a direct inguinal hernia. So now we have understood the basics of an inguinal hernia, but there are two varieties of inguinal hernia that we need to understand. One is called a direct inguinal hernia and one is called an indirect inguinal hernia. Indirect hernias are more common in young people, and generally more common. Direct hernias are more common in older age group. The difference is that in indirect inguinal hernia, that is the hernia that we have been discussing so far, the contents come through the deep inguinal ring, go through the inguinal canal, and then it depends how far they go into the scrotum. So basically this hernia, the neck of this hernia, as you see here, is at the deep inguinal ring, immediately lateral to the inferior epigastric vessels. This is the left side. On the other hand, a direct hernia, the neck is wider, as you see here, the neck is wider and lies medial to the inferior epigastric vessels. Basically, if you remember in the first picture I showed you, the white background behind the inguinal canal. So the area between the deep ring and the superficial ring, this is the deep ring here and this is the superficial ring, and the posterior wall formed by the transversalis fascia and the peritoneum and fibers of the transversus abdominis muscle, that is pushed out into the inguinal canal and may even come out through the superficial ring into the scrotum. So this is not following the original anatomical track from the deep ring to the superficial ring. It is taking a shortcut from the posterior wall directly into the inguinal canal and then may come out of the superficial ring. So this is a direct hernia, and both of them will of course present in the inguinal swelling. So you have to differentiate in the outdoor as well as during surgery between the two, as the operative repair is slightly different in both. Another view here, let's come to this picture first. The mid inguinal point, as I explained, lies in the middle of a line drawn from the anterior superior iliac spine to the symphysis pubis. Whereas the inguinal ligament extends from the anterior superior iliac spine to the pubic tubercle, which is on the lateral edge of the pubic part of the pubic bone. So the inguinal ligament is shorter, so its midpoint would be lying a little bit lateral to the middle of this line drawn from the anterior superior iliac spine to the symphysis pubis. This is called the mid-inguinal point, while the middle of the inguinal ligament is slightly lateral to the mid-inguinal point. The deep ring lies at the mid-inguinal point. So the location of the purpose of discussing all this is to identify the location of the mid-inguinal point. So that would be a little bit medial to the middle of the inguinal ligament. Here again, another view at the anatomy, the anterior superior iliac spine. Here we are looking at the left side anterior view. Here we are looking at the right side anterior view, acetabulum, anterior superior iliac spine, and the pubic tubercle and pubic crest here. This is the inguinal ligament, the infralateral cruce, the supromedial cruce, the medial cruce, the spermatic cord coming out. This is the superficial inguinal ring. This is the deep inguinal ring, and this is the inguinal canal, arches of the external oblique forming the anterior wall of the inguinal canal. And please remember, for a novice surgeons, it is very easy during the repair of the posterior wall of the inguinal canal. You see the femoral vein immediately behind the inguinal canal and the femoral artery. It is very easy to pass your needle through the inguinal ligament and go into the vein. So that has to be remembered. And also remember the anatomy of this lacunar ligament and this potential space in medial to the this femoral in this femoral sheath. This is the artery, this is the vein, and this is the femoral canal, and immediately medial to that you have the lacunar ligament. This is the potential space where a lymph node lies, and this is the place where the inguinal hernia comes through. So now you can imagine an indirect hernia. The bulge will start here and could go anywhere into the scrotum, so this whole area would be bulging. In an indirect hernia, the hernia would be coming medial to the inferior epigastric vessel, so it would be causing a bulge here and it can go into the scrotum. And a femoral hernia would be coming out here and it can even bulge upwards. So basically all three different types of hernias are presenting in this area. So indirect hernias are the most common types of hernia, 65%. They are common in younger age group as compared to direct hernia, which is more common in elderly, because that is not because of the anatomical weakness, rather due to not because of the inherent anatomical weakness of the deep inguinal ring, but rather because of the muscle weakness in old age. Quickly, we'll go through. There are three main types of indirect hernias. Bubonocele is a swelling which presents inside the inguinal canal. Funicular hernia is where the sac extends out of the superficial inguinal ring but does not go down, but finishes above the testes. Then we have a complete or a scrotal form, where the hernial sac goes beyond the testes up to the floor of the scrotum. Bubonocele, funicular, scrotal. So this helps in this terminology helps in describing the hernia when you're writing the diagnosis. Direct hernias are 35% of the inguinal hernias. Uncommon females always acquired due to weakening of the posterior wall of the inguinal canal, and the hernia is medial to the inferior epigastric artery. So coverings of a direct hernia, because this is taking a shortcut route, would be extraperitoneal fascia, fascia transversalis, the conjoint tendon, the external spermatic fascia, and the skin. If this is the deep inguinal ring, the direct hernia is presenting as a bulge in the posterior wall. If the swelling is soft and elastic, usually it contains gut. If it is firm and granular, usually it contains greater omentum. Now, one sign of a hernia is cuff impulse. It is the characteristic feature of a hernia and can be felt on palpation, seeing as bulging in inspection. Ask the patient to cuff. We will discuss the reducible and irreducible hernias in a short while. But in reducible hernias, at least, cuff impulse will always be there. When a patient cuffs, the neck, the hernia bulges. You can see that on inspection. And if you put your hand on it, you can feel the cuff impulse under your hand, the bulge that comes out on cuffing. So that is called cuff impulse. That is first confirmatory sign of a hernia. In scrotal swellings, because there can be a hydrocele or an enlarged testes or an encysted hydrocele of the spermatic cord, in all those these three conditions, you will have a swelling in the scrotum, and you have to differentiate it from a scrotal hernia. So on the one hand, there will not be a cuff impulse if you hold the scrotum in your hand. On the other hand, when you trace the upper margin, if you can get above the swelling, then this swelling is arising from the scrotum. It is not a hernia coming from above. And in case of inguinoscrotal hernia, because the neck is above inside the inguinal canal, whether it is a direct or an indirect hernia, so if you start palpating from below and try to reach the upper margin of the swelling, you cannot. So in case of a hernia, it is an inguinoscrotal swelling, and you cannot get above the swelling. Then there's the internal ring occlusion test. Internal ring is located about 1.25 or half centimeters or half an inch above the mid inguinal point, which we, as we discussed, is the mid inguinal point, not the middle of the inguinal ligament. And after the contents have been reduced, meaning thereby that all the contents have been manipulated to go back inside the abdominal cavity, when the patient is lying down, the internal ring is occluded using the thumb and the patient is asked to cuff. If a swelling appears medial to the thumb, then it is a direct hernia. And if the swelling does not appear when the thumb is there and only appears on releasing the thumb, then the swelling has come out through the deep ring. So it is an indirect hernia. So this internal ring occlusion test is a sign where you can differentiate between a direct and an indirect hernia. Again, as I said already, this is the Hasselbeck's triangle. We are looking at the right side from the front, the Hasselbeck's triangle from the front. This is forming the posterior wall of the inguinal canal. This is a deep ring, the femoral artery, femoral vein, and the femoral canal. So indirect hernia will come out here, direct hernia will come out here, and femoral hernia will come out here. So they will all present in this area. Then there's a ring invagination test. Usually we don't do it because it is generally uncomfortable for the patient. But after reduction of the hernia, the little finger of the examiner is used to invaginate the skin from the bottom of the scrotum and gradually pushed up and rotated to enter the superficial inguinal ring. And impulse on cuffing, if impulse is felt at the tip of the invaginated finger, it is an indirect hernia. And if it is palpated on the pulp of the invaginated finger, then of course it is the posterior wall of the canal that is bulging. So it is a direct hernia. This test is done only in males, but usually it is avoided because it is uncomfortable for the patient. Zeeman's test is where you want to differentiate between a direct, indirect, and a femoral hernia. So the examiner standing lateral to the patient, the patient is lying down, the hernial contents have been reduced. You place the index finger on the deep inguinal ring at the mid inguinal point, place the middle finger at the superficial inguinal ring, and the ring finger at the femoral location of the femoral canal or in the saphenous opening, and then ask the patient to cuff or to hold the nose and blow. If the impulse is felt on the index finger, that is at the deep ring, then it is an indirect hernia. Remember, the contents have been reduced. If it is felt at the middle finger, then it is the posterior wall of the canal that is bulging, it is a direct hernia. And if it is felt at the ring finger, at the femoral canal area, then it is a femoral hernia. That's the Zeeman's test. Indirect hernia starting from the middle of the inguinal ligament, funicular type coming here, and there's a direct hernia bulging out through the posterior wall and the superficial ring. So what is the differential diagnosis of inguinal hernias? Hydrocele, as I mentioned earlier, it can be infantile or encysted hydrocele, or it can be a large vaginal or a bilocular, even patent processus vaginalis. And then you have undescended or maldescended testes, which is lying inside the inguinal canal, and you feel that as a bulge. Femoral hernia also comes in the differential diagnosis of an inguinal hernia. Then you can have a lipoma of the spermatic cord. Then you can have a hydrocele. Hydrocele is accumulation of water-like fluid inside an epithelial cavity of the canal of Noack in females. And then you can have enlargement of the inguinal lymph node presenting as a mass or bulge in the inguinal area. Then you can have a groin abscess, and of special importance is the psoas muscle cold abscess, which is actually caries of the spine, which tracks under the sheath of the psoas muscle and presents under the inguinal ligament. And because this comes as, is secondary to caries of the spine, which is tuberculous, so this is a cold abscess. It will not be hot to touch like any other abscess. So this can be easily confused with the femoral or an inguinal hernia, but it will present just below the inguinal ligament behind the femoral vessels. Not too many investigations are required. Hernias are basically identified clinically. Routine investigations and chest X-ray to exclude COIDs. Pulmonary disorders, chronic cough, and obstructive airway diseases, ultrasonography of the abdomen and pelvis to rule out prostate enlargement or any mass inside the abdomen that is pushing the contents out. Rarely you need a CT scan of the abdomen in incisional hernias to see the number of hernias where they have projected. So the first principle of treating any hernia is to treat the precipitating cause first. If there is any reason for chronic cough, urinary outlet obstruction, chronic constipation, muscle weakness. You must focus on treating the primary cause first. And then there is no medical treatment of hernias because there is an anatomical defect in the muscles. This has to be corrected by surgeries only. In children, especially under 5 years of age, simple herniotomy is enough. But in adults, herniotomy, herniorrhaphy, and hernioplasty are the three different techniques which form treatment of the hernia. Herniotomy is basically ligation of the neck of the sac after reducing the contents and excising the body and the fundus of the sac, and that's all. So basically you are just removing the peritoneal sac after reducing the contents. In case of herniorrhaphy, you are trying to repair the defect in the posterior wall of the inguinal canal. There is Scholdes repair, McVay repair, modified Bassini repairs, but all of them have relatively higher recurrence rates as the repair is done under tension. So the second most important criteria for treating hernias anywhere is to try to repair under minimum tension, closing the gap without undue tension, because the stitches, the proline that you put in, that tends to cut through the muscle and the ligaments through which it has been passed with repeated cuffing or straining, and so minimal tension is. As you remember in the last slide, we said first treat the cause of the hernia, and then the second rule is to repair with least tension. So we are talking herniorrhaphy here. Complications include hemorrhage, hematoma formation, infection, hematocele formation, post herniorrhaphy hydrocele, lymphocele of the testes and around the testes, because your repair is too tight and that is constricting the spermatic cord. Hyperesthesia over the medial side of the inguinal canal due to injury to ilioinguinal nerve, which is neuralgia. The hernia can recur. There can be osteitis pubis, which is inflammation of the pubic bone because of your infected needle passing through the periosteum when you start the repair. Then there can be injury to the urinary bladder or bowel if it is forming the posterior wall of the inguinal canal. And then there can be testicular atrophy, penile edema rarely. Again, it depends on too much tightening of the deep ring causing vascular insufficiency to the testes. Hernioplasty is strengthening of the posterior inguinal canal in case of indirect hernia and in any large hernia with weak abdominal wall using a supportive material. So hernioplasty is where you use a supportive material, extraneous supporting material, to reinforce the posterior wall of the inguinal canal. This allows and supports good fibroblast proliferation, which in turn strengthens the weak posterior wall of inguinal canal or abdominal canal. Presently, hernioplasty is the procedure of choice. Mesh is placed either as onlay over the conjoint tendon to inguinal ligament or inlay in the preperitoneal space. Usually polypropylene, that is proline mesh, is used, and herniotomy is done prior to the mesh placement. There are different methods: Lichtenstein, Rives, Gilbert, Stopa. Then you have endoscopic repairs like TAP and TAP, but that is beyond the scope of undergraduates. You see the mesh being placed here to cover the weak posterior wall. It is in place. Hernias can get complicated. As I said earlier, you need to remember a hernia can be a reducible hernia or an irreducible hernia. Reducible is where the contents can be returned to the abdomen, and irreducible is where contents cannot be returned to the abdomen due to narrow neck, adhesions inside the peritoneal sac, overcrowding, and this irreducibility predisposes to strangulation of the contents of the hernial sac. So, on the one hand is uncomplicated reducible hernias, then first complication would be an irreducible hernia. This irreducible hernia may simply be because of adhesions inside the peritoneal sac, because of long-standing hernias, but then this irreducible hernia further can have two more complications. One is obstruction, where you call obstructed hernia, where the contents, the small bowel develops intestinal obstruction because of the narrow neck. And then you can have strangulation, where the blood supply to the bowel that is herniated and now irreducible, the blood supply is compromised and ischemia of the gut takes place. That is strangulation. Obstructed hernia, it is an irreducible hernia with obstruction, blood intestinal obstruction, but blood supply to the bowel is not interfered. And ultimately, it will swell up and lead to compromise of the blood supply and lead to strangulation. And Gary stricture is a constriction that occurs due to ischemic narrowing of a small bowel, which has reduced from an obstructed hernia. If a small bowel remained obstructed for some time, and the tight ring leads to a line, circular line around the lumen of the circumference of the bowel that had become ischemic. And even if that has been manipulated and reduced, later on that ischemic ring becomes fibrotic and causes a stricture called Gary's stricture, which can then lead to intestinal obstruction, whether subacute or acute. Then there is another thing where you have to distinguish between strangulated contents and inflamed contents of the hernial sac. For example, an appendix in the when it is inflamed appendix inside the contents, it may not be a irreducible hernia, it may not be an obstructed hernia, it may not be a strangulated hernia, but it will look like it is a strangulated hernia, because it will be painful and tender. Similarly, fallopian tube, salpingitis, inflamed fallopian tube inside the hernia will feel painful and tender. But please remember, the hernia is tender but not tense. The overlying skin is red and edematous. Obstructed hernias are tense. Strangulated hernia, as I've already explained, it occurs when blood supply of the contents of the hernia is seriously impaired, which may ultimately lead to formation of gangrene. The obstruction at the narrow neck, initially the veins, the venous return is hampered, the veins get compressed because they have low pressure. The arterial blood keeps getting in. So the venous return is reduced, so these contents start swelling up. The congestion of the bowel leads to further dilatation of the bowel, which becomes venous. Venous congestion gives it the purple color. Extravasation of fluid inside the sac through the content. Eventually the arterial blood supply also gets choked because of this swelling, and the bowel becomes dark and brownish black. And bacteria transmigrate from inside the lumen into this fluid of the sac. So this fluid is highly infective and can lead to post-operative wound infection once you're operating. Perforation of the gut usually occurs at this tight ring. And if this occurs, the infected gut contents will go into the peritoneum and cause peritonitis, which will later lead to sepsis and death. So for strangulated hernias, please remember it is an emergency herniotomy. Other hernias can linger for years and years, but in case of an obstructed and a strangulated hernia, it is a surgical emergency to do the herniotomy. The technique is slightly different, but the ultimate treatment remains surgery. Patient admitted for obstruction, Ryle's tube, the nasogastric tube, is done to decompress the stomach and bowel. Intravenous fluids are started to correct the dehydration and electrolyte imbalance. Antibiotic cover is given. Foley's catheterization is done to maintain adequate urine output. Basically, you are preparing the patient for surgery, making them stable to sustain the surgery and anesthesia, but the treatment remains emergency herniotomy. Now, different varieties. Meidel's hernia is where two adjacent loops of the gut have gone in and there is strangulated segment because it is narrowed and the blood supply is coming like this. It is the strangulated segment lies inside the abdomen. It is like a W, and so this will cause peritonitis and difficult diagnosis and will need a laparotomy. Common sites: revised epigastric hernia, lumbar hernia, paraumbilical hernia, umbilical hernia, spigelian hernia, inguinal hernia, femoral hernia. Femoral hernia, we have discussed already the anatomy of the femoral canal, which contains the lymph node of Ploquet, 1.25 cm long, 1.25 cm wide. The femoral ring is bounded anteriorly by the inguinal ligament, posteriorly by the iliopectinian ligament of Cooper, pubic bone and the fascia covering the pectineus muscle, medially by the concave, sharp, lacunar or the Gimbernat's ligament, laterally by a thin septum separating from the femoral vein. As I have already discussed with you, the femoral nerve does not lie in the femoral sheath. The femoral artery, vein and the femoral canal are the contents of the femoral sheath, and the medial margin is formed by the lacunar ligament between the inguinal ligament and the pubic bone. Femoral hernia presents just below the inguinal ligament, but it can present, the bulge can come even higher, or it can present as a swelling in the upper medial thigh. Pantaloon hernia, where both direct and indirect inguinal sacs are present and clinically present as a direct hernia. During surgery, the indirect sac may be missed and so leads to recurrent hernia through the indirect sac. So it is always better when you're treating a direct inguinal hernia to explore the spermatic cord and look for second component. The two legs of the pantaloon are, one is medial and the other is medial and behind, and the other is lateral and anterior to the inferior epigastric vessels. Ventral hernia is any protrusion through the abdominal wall, anterior abdominal wall, with the exception of the inguinofemoral region. So generally incisional hernias form 80% of the ventral hernias. However, umbilical, paraumbilical and epigastric hernias and the spigelian hernia would also be called ventral hernias. Umbilical hernia, where the hernia is central, protruding centrally through the abdomen, umbilical scar is seen in infants, and it is generally treated conservatively for 2 years of age. especially if the size is less than 2 centimeters, and it may disappear by itself. Otherwise, it can be treated surgically. So this would be seen in infants, and it is because of incomplete closure of the umbilical orifice. Paraumbilical hernia, on the other hand, it occurs commonly in adults, as I said, after pregnancy in women. It is a protrusion or herniation through the linea alba, basically, not through the umbilical scar, just above or below the umbilicus. And it to differentiate it from epigastric hernia or umbilical hernia, the umbilical hernia comes centrally through the umbilical scar, so all the four walls of the umbilical hernia are found by the umbilicus itself. But in paraumbilical hernia, umbilicus forms only one wall of the hernia. In epigastric hernias, which also comes through the linea alba, but that is higher up, and the umbilicus does not form any part of any wall of the epigastric hernias. Otherwise, they essentially remain all three. Only the location is different, otherwise the treatment remains the same. Paraumbilical hernia presents as swelling in the smooth surface, distinct edges and impulse on cuff is there, may be reducible. Surgery is the treatment of choice. Dissection of sac with mesh placement where the hernial defect is more than 2 centimeters. Where the defect is less than 2 centimeters, Mayo's operation, double breasting of the rectus sheath may be done. Incisional hernias are complicated topics, not for undergraduates. But basically, what you have to understand is that vertical midline scars and lower abdominal scars are weak areas, especially before the advent of proline for closure, when catgut was used. But even now, using proline under tension, or if the wound gets infected, the proline cuts through and then the area becomes weak and incisional hernias can form. And this is a complicated topic, and I don't think it is important for the undergraduates, but if you want, you can go through this. Another rare form, spigelian hernia, arises at the lateral margin of the linea semilunaris, at the lateral margin of the rectus sheath, usually below the umbilicus, and presents as an interparietal hernia between the muscles, external oblique and internal oblique. And the treatment is a lengthy transverse incisional herniotomy and closure of the defect layer by layer using non-interrupted sutures, and a mesh may be required over it. You just need to know what is a spigelian hernia, I think, not more than that. Epigastric hernia, I have already discussed. Small epigastric hernias usually only contain extra peritoneal fat. They may not even contain a peritoneal sac. And they can be multiple in the midline, in the linea alba, anywhere between the Zeffy sternum and the umbilicus. So this would be one condition where if you see one epigastric hernia, you may opt for a CT scan of the abdominal wall or an ultrasonography to see if there are others above it or below it, so that you address all of them at the same time. Generally, these are because of obesity, high intra-abdominal fatty content, pushing the fat, extra peritoneal fat, through the fibers of the linea alba. Here you see an epigastric hernia. This is the linea alba between the Zeffy sternum and the umbilicus. It can be anywhere and it can be multiple in this area. Rictus hernia is a hernia in which the sac contains only a portion of the circumference of the intestine. As you remember, I pointed this out earlier, and it is usually seen in femoral or obturator hernias, which are very narrow necked hernias, and initially there may be gastroenteritis like spurious diarrhea, but later on toxicity and vomiting and gangrene of the strangulation of strangulated part of the circumference of the gut and peritonitis may occur, and it will need resection and anastomosis of the loop, involved loop of the gut. And at the end we come to the phantom hernia. It is a muscular bulge as a result of local muscular paralysis. This may either be because of interference with the nerve supply of the affected muscle. For example, you had a surgery like cholecystectomy or an appendicectomy where the muscle cutting was done, and the local muscle has been deprived of its nerve supply because during the incision, previous incision, the nerve was cut, and that muscle is now lying paralyzed there. So when the patient coughs, that muscle bulges out. So, or poliomyelitis of the lumbar region, that can also cause muscle paralysis. So here the abdominal anatomically there is no defect in the abdominal musculature through which the abdominal contents are protruding, but actually it clinically it looks like a hernia, because when you ask the patient to cough or when the patient stands up, the area bulges out and it looks like a hernia, and you have to differentiate it clinically from an actual hernia. So this would be called a phantom hernia. So it was a long topic. Hernias is definitely not possible to do in one lecture in any greater detail. I have tried to cover all important aspects of the hernias, and I think they should be sufficient at your undergraduate level. And thank you very much. And I will see you soon with your next online lecture. And most probably we'll be discussing burns.